Okay, thank you for remaining after the lecture yesterday. Today, as I anticipated, will be the day that we discuss the construction of the entanglement entropy by means of field theory. But before making this, in order to try to let a larger number of you understanding what I'm telling, I want to show an approach that shares many characteristics with quantum field theory, but that maybe is more familiar to some of you, if not all, which is how you to write the reduced density matrix and the entanglement entropy with the matrix product states. Okay? So maybe someone is familiar with this language and will understand the story here. Someone else will not be familiar with matrix product states, and we'll understand only the field theory part. Okay, but, so, in a matrix product state, imagine you have a spin chain, just so. Okay? What you do with a matrix product state is to assign to every spin a tensor, a let's say I, where I denotes the position of the spin, S1, one for the component plus of the spin 1/2, one for the component minus of the spin 1/2, okay? So this is a chi times chi tensor or matrix if you want. Okay, let's say A1, S1 on the spin 1, A2, S2 on the other, etc. So, and this is a tensor, chi time chi tensor. Okay? This tensor is usually denoted with this symbol. Okay? So it's just a square where the leg that moves up or down is the physical index SI, S1. So this leg means that there is an index that is not contracted that can be either plus or minus 1. Okay? While the leg that appear here is I and this one is J, where I and J are the two indices of the chi times chi matrix. Okay? Yes? I didn't consider anything yet. I say that to each site I give you a tensor, which for the moment is still, this is the first one, then there will be the second one, A2, S2, A3, S3, and I didn't say that they are all equal to, that would imply that I have periodic boundary condition. Yes? Yes, I'm taking a spin chain of 1/2, so all local. Yes, all the SI are 1/2. I don't want to make. Let's not cook up crazy examples. You know, let's. I will represent the state of the system, okay? As the sum over all possible spin external index configuration, S1, S2, Sn equal plus or minus 1/2, or I write y, 1, not 1/2. And then we don't specify any boundary condition, so we take A1, S1, A2, S2, okay? Where here What we mean is the matrix by row product between these matrices. In graphical representation, this you just represent as okay? Where the fact that these lines are contracted here, it means that the repeated index are some that you made them row by column multiplication of matrix, okay?
Psi depends on psi.
I didn't say anything yet. Wait. Okay, this is a construction that I can do. I can always do this story. Can do with chi equal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? I want, first of all, that you understand what is written here. I should specify what happened at the boundary here, but okay, let's assume that the system is infinite, so we don't have to wonder whether we should close it or we should put some state on the boundary. It's not important for where I want to go, okay? Imagine that just this guy goes over all the way here and continue all the way here. Like for the expert could be an ITBD. Okay, it's clear what this plot means. You will find these things everywhere, so better to say it once if you never saw them. So these are the physical indices, okay, the basis in which we are writing the thing. And this object represents the tensor that is 1 over every side. All right, which states I can approximate or I can write in this notation? And this is the first question. Obviously, will depend on the dimension of this tensor chi, as your colleague said, okay? So, I can imagine that clearly. Let's go to make it easy to the case where all these tensors are equal, like that we have a translation invariant system. Okay? So, infinite, all equal. The number of terms that is inside each sensor is chi square. Okay? So I have chi square parameter, and with chi square parameter I cannot describe all possible state of nature. Okay? What you can easily show is that if chi is equal to 2 to the n, where n is the number of spin and eventually it's infinity, you can write exactly write any state as an MPS, matrix product state. But this is not the game that you are usually playing. Usually you want a chi much smaller than 2 to the n, okay, and still have a faithful representation of the state of interest. And the key to understand which state you can faithfully represent with some finite chi, okay, is again the entanglement. Because but it's not the maximum entanglement of a chi time chi tensor, okay, MPS, is logarithm of chi. This happens when all the maximum entanglement is when the various eigenvalues are all the same, because if you start decreasing one, obviously you get less entanglement, and when they are all the same, since it's a chi times chi matrix, each eigenvalue should be 1 over chi, because they should be summed to 1, and the corresponding entanglement entropy is log chi. Okay, so this is really follows from what we had done already yesterday with no calculation. So if with a given chi you can capture the entanglement entropy of the worst bipartition of your state, like half bipartition, then it means that the state is representable with a matrix product state. For example, we say that in one dimension, there is the area law, okay? The area law means the entanglement saturates to some value, it's finite, so you have to fix chi to be the exponential of whatever, okay? For a gap, one D system, SA equal constant. So it's enough that log chi is equal to this constant, which means chi equal the exponential of this constant, which will be 3, 4, 5, 10, but still it's a finite number. Okay? And so with the finite chi, you can represent this state. Okay? For a one-dimensional gapless system, we say that the entanglement entropy was C over 3 log L. If you match this with log chi, then you follow that chi should go like L to the C over 3. So it means that the dimension of your bond dimension, that's how it's called chi, must grow polynomially in L, in subsystem size or system size, which is still something that's doable. Okay, so, and that's why matrix product states works in 1D. In D greater than 1, the entanglement entropy grows like the area, which means L to the D minus 1. If this must be equal to log chi, you have that chi must be equal to the exponential, okay? To the exponential of L to the D minus 1. And in this case, the bond dimension should grow like the exponential of your system or subsystem size, and this is not possible, okay? At some point, very soon, when you increase your system size, the thing will break down, and in fact, MPS work only in 1D. This is not the reason why I introduced this state, but I introduced this state to write the reduced density matrix now. And, but okay, this was a good detour to let you know one of the most important aspects that the theory of entanglement explained in the last 10 years. Yes. I'm talking about grounds. Yes, yes, it's. I don't know anything about Eigen state like that. I mean, it's not part of what we want to discuss here. It's, okay? I'm talking about ground state of local Hamiltonian. Then we can say what happened in time evolution. It's, let's fix to what we are talking about. It's, if you want something else, discuss out of the lecture. Okay, it's not, if you want to discuss, I don't know, gravity, quantization of gravity, let's discuss in another moment. It doesn't depend on subsystem size. That's what we did yesterday. Doesn't depend on subsystem size. That's what we discussed yesterday quite a lot. I hope, okay, if every day I should repeat the things, it, we don't move from here. Are you every day, day by day, checking what we are doing here? Because else it makes little sense. Okay? So this is the state. Our state psi, let me rewrite, can be written in this way. We want to write the reduced density matrix in this notation. So first of all, we should write the density matrix, which is nothing but psi, the projector on the state. And in this notation, you write the density matrix as okay, where? So this is, in this notation, it's like it. This guy here is the cat, and this other guy here is the bra of the reduced density matrix. And you see that there are non-contracted indices corresponding to the row and the column of the density matrix, okay? These indices here, okay, corresponds to S. I, as it was written here, and are the non-contracted element of the density matrix of the state. And if you write two copies of these, it means that are the non-contracted index of the row and the column. If now you want to get the reduced density matrix, what you should do, you should decide which part is A of the system. Let's imagine that A are these two spins here in the middle, okay? And what you have to do is that in the rest of the system, you must contract, okay? Because you have to make trace over the B degrees of freedom. Rho A is equal to the trace over the B degrees of freedom of rho, which means that the sum over the Si belonging to B of the rho. Sum over Si means contract an index. Okay, so if I rewrite this guy here, means that I'm contracting these indices, okay, and all the other that are maybe on this other side, and this other side, and I'm leaving uncontracted just the indices corresponding to A. And this is a representation of reduced density matrix. Now, if I want to calculate like trace of rho A to the square, I should just take two of these matrices. Okay, this is one. This is the other, okay, where there are these open indices. Okay, and then I should make the product of these two matrices. What does it mean to make the product of these two matrices? Okay, that if this is like, let's abuse with the notation. Let's say that this is I1 and I2, meaning it's not the I of before, but it's the column index of this matrix. This is J1 and J2, the column index of this matrix. Again, here I have I1 and I2, J1 and J2. Okay? And if I make the product, what I should do, I should identify the row of one matrix with the column of the other, okay? So if this is the first, it means that I should connect with this J1, should identify with this I1, so I should contract in this way, and the same on the other side. And then I want to take the trace, it means that I should even contract this guy with this one down here, and this one with this one down here. I hope you understand this plot. Okay, what happened here is that the spin belongings to B are just contracted between themselves inside the same system, while the spins belonging to A are contracted between the two copy of your system. Okay? This plot is the essence of the replica trick that we use in field theory. Okay, that's why I wanted to introduce in this other context, maybe because most of you are not familiar with field theory. Okay? Then maybe there is someone of you that knows anything about spin and knows only field theory, and this is just a begged detour. But and this concept of the replica trick is very important because it has been first introduced in field theory, as we will use in a second. And, okay, then it's the same story with the magic process state, but most importantly, recent experiment in cold atoms were able to measure entanglement-related quantity exactly by making this story. They prepared two copies of the system, they coupled in some particular way, and they were able to extract the entanglement entropy. Okay? So this can sound a very theoretical and artificial construction, but actually it's what they do in real lab. Okay? Do you have any question? All the indices are separated. A trace of rho to anything, it's a number, okay? Which means that there is no leftover index, okay? It's open indices means that there is still a tensor structure. So every time you find a number, you have to eliminate all the open legs. Okay, but trace of rho to the n, I can write you, it's just. Let's make only one spin that is easy. If there are many of them, you just. Okay, here it means that the rest is contracted as it should. You understand this object, no? So this is one row, this is another row, and this is a third row. Okay, what you should do, you should connect the first line of the first with the second, this one with this, and then you should close cyclically the first and the last. And okay, you can go on up to n equal whatever you want. It's always the same story. You multiply one times the second, and the last one for the trace, you close. But we will see this abundantly when in field theory, it's the same story. Clear to everyone? Who knew matrix product state before? Not that you know after, because. Okay, so it was a good idea to start with this. Who knows the replica trick in field theory instead? Okay, so much less, so the order of explanation was good for the majority of people. Now, I hope you. As students understand that teaching to such a variety of people is extremely complicated, okay? You have very different background with the, so I'm just trying to optimize the understanding, but okay, obviously, you're not a uniform class like in normal school. Okay, so now what we will try to do is to repeat this kind of construction for field theory, reverting the historical order where first came the field theory, but okay, since you are most familiar with this, probably this is the best thing to do. Okay, and for sake of simplicity, I will just write down things in one dimension, but everything that I'm writing is valid in arbitrary dimension. Okay, so. Just to write and to draw things nicely, we use 1D, but, okay? Everything we do today, valid in any D. Just you have to draw and to have more indices in your formulas. So, reduced density matrix in quantum field theory. That's the first step. To have everything well defined, let's start with the lattice quantum field theory, which means that your field theory has been discretized on a lattice, so that we don't have, right? So exactly like the spin chain of before, you have your one-dimensional lattices and your field theory defined on it. To define a field theory on these lattices means that you had a we denote by phi to the x a set of local commuting observable. Actually, a complete set. Right? Which means a set of observable which completely characterize the theory. Like in the case of a spin chain, here you have just SZ. Okay, so that you, when you specify the eigenvalue plus or minus one, you know which states you have on that side. Okay, depending on which field theory you have, you can have different fields. You know this story. Okay, if you don't know, just have in mind that there are a set of observable whose eigenvalues span all the Hilbert space of the system, okay? And in fact, I will denote as pi x the eigenvalues and with product of x by x, the eigenvector. Okay, if you don't understand this notation, just think for 1 second to the spin 1/2. Okay? The observable is sigma z, the eigenvalues are plus or minus one, one for each side, and the eigenstate, in fact, are plus, minus, minus, minus. This is a possible eigenstate, okay? So this is what these three guys mean. Phi. Phi as operator. Phi as eigenstate and phi as state. Okay? There is a set of observable, okay, which is complete in the sense that all these eigenvalues span the Hilbert space, local Hilbert space in one lattice site. Okay? And then the generic eigenstate, the generic state of the theory can be written as a superposition of the state that have the various possibility in each place, okay? So this is completely trivial for the case of the spin 1/2, but in the most general case can be something extremely complicated, okay? So are you with me with this notation? That's the most important thing. When you understand the notation, it's easier. X, because, okay, this will become continuous, no? This is X space direction. Let's say that lattice spacing is A, that at the end of the day will go to zero. Okay, so you have your X that is 1A, 2A, 3A, 4A, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Exactly the I of before, but okay, now since we want to make the continuous limit, we just measure everything in units of A. And at some point, we will make this limit. Actually, we'll make the limit, and we will not even realize that we make the limit, because we write things so nicely that the limit will be automatic. Oh, it's clear. Tensor product over x of phi. Phi is the eigenvalues at the position x, which means this guy here. Okay, when I write that a state is plus minus at I, means that it's the tensor product of the plus at site one, the minus at site two. Okay, what does mean this notation? This notation means a tensor product. We are so used to this notation that we don't think anymore what it is, but okay. So this notation here stands for this guy. Every time that I write a formula, when you don't understand it, think in your mind what will be back for the spin chain, and then, okay, you just understand that this is a generalization to an arbitrary field. And if you still don't understand, ask me. Okay. We want to work in field theory, so we'll say that our system has Hamiltonian H to which it corresponds an Euclidean Lagrangian that I will denote by LE. Just, I will work in imaginary time. That's why in Euclidean space. Okay? And you know how to get from the Hamiltonian to Lagrangian. You just write the Lagrangian transform. Okay? And Euclidean action SE, which is equal to the integral between 0 and tau in d tau of the Lagrangian. What 0 and tau? 0 and beta, because we will be at finite temperature beta and then send beta to infinity. Okay, so beta is the inverse temperature equal 1 over t. Okay? And in the case of infinite of zero temperature, infinite beta, the integral is just up to infinity as usual. Okay, so in this field theory, we should write what is written here, the reduced density matrix. So before taking the reduced density matrix, let's write the density matrix in field theory. Okay? The density matrix at finite temperature at finite T is rho equal e to the minus beta h divided by z, partition function to have it normalized to 1. Okay? This you know has nothing to do with field theory. So let's write this object in this path integral formula, in a path integral formulation in field theory. Questions? Well, it's okay, yeah, just ask even stupid questions. I'm very happy. Euclidean Lagrangian means, you know what is Lagrangian, okay? This is usually in real time. T, T goes in IT, and this is Euclidean. Yes. So T, tau everywhere is imaginary time. Equal I t the norm, the real time. That's, as you well know, if to beta here you put I t, you get time evolution operator, and everything at flat temperature corresponds to imaginary time. Okay, that's, I didn't stress too much this because I told most of you know, but just to be clear on the notation, let's repeat it. Okay, you see that if here you put I t instead of beta, you get evolution in real time. Okay, so if you want to work at flat temperature, usually what you do is to work in imaginary time. And that's the approach that is usually followed in field theory, but not only in field theory. Okay, thank you for the question. At least clarify something. Other questions? So don't. Okay, so to understand what is this density matrix, in our formulation, what we should do? We should write this density matrix. It seems a cool tautology. We write that density matrix in our basis, in our notation, okay? So let's write the element of the reduced density matrix between two states of our basis. The states of our basis are identified by this phi, okay? So let me write in this way, product over x, one, to say one point, phi of x1. This is the first, this is one element, and this is product over x2, phi of x2. Okay? And this is clearly the expectation value on the state. What I'm writing now, it's a tautology, but it's good to understand what will go on. Divide the partition function. Okay, what I'm doing is that I'm just telling that the element of my operator is just the operator evaluated on the on that states that I'm interested in. Okay, it's really a tautology, but better to rewrite it. And now, what is this object? It's already written there, actually, but what is in a path integral formulation? Okay. This is nothing but. Let me first draw and then explain, and you can. I take a strip of width beta, okay, divided by z every time. So I take a strip of width beta, and on top I put the state, let's say, phi 2 of x 2, and down I put phi 1 of x 1. In each point. Okay, so look at this expression. You start from phi 1 at x 1, for example, at tau equal to 0. You let it evolve for imaginary. So in this path integral formulation, here is space and here is time. Okay, as usual, horizontal line is space, vertical line is time. Okay, so you start from a given configuration of phi 1 of x 1. Which means for the spin chain plus one, plus minus, plus minus, plus minus, here phi one of x one, whatever they are. Okay? You let it evolve for imaginary time in beta. Okay, that's what is written here. And then you make the cat, the bra, with phi two of x two after that time. Okay, so you start from some configuration, you evolve for some time, and then you impose that should arrive after this time to fight u of x2, which will be another configuration of plus minus in your spin chain. So I just, this is the formula. This is what you will write in path integral for the same thing. If you have something that you don't understand in this thing, just ask now. There is not much to understand just to be familiar with the concept, but if you are not familiar, it can be complicated. So tell me what makes you uncomfortable. I will try to make, to explain it to you. You all have seen path integral in one way or another. Yes? Who never saw a path integral in his life? Okay, so more or less you understand this notation, no? To understand it a bit better, let's see something very stupid. What happens if I take in this notation the trace of rho? What is the trace of rho? It must be one, no? That's how we can see it. Okay, so this is the element of the reduced density method. Taking the trace means that we have to take the diagonal element and sum over them. Correct? What are the diagonal elements in this notation? One of you that answer. Okay, so phi 1 is equal to phi 2 at each point, okay? That means diagonal. So this is the diagonal element. And then I have to sum over them. Okay. And in a plot, what does it mean? That I should take this strip, okay, identify the point on the opposite direction, and then sum over them. So it means I make a path integral over on that as well. And what I get if I do this operation? I take a strip, I close it. What it is, this guy? It's a cylinder of circumference beta. Okay, so this is the standard construction that I think at least 80% of you heard, that the partition function at flat temperature is the path integral on a cylinder. Who already heard this story? Come on. Rise hands. Don't be shy. Okay, so. I don't know how you prove it, probably in this way, or probably you went through Matsubara. That is something a bit crazy, but, okay, but this is the easiest way to see that the partition function on the cylinder, the partition function is the path integral on the cylinder. In fact, okay. The trace of rho is 1, so it means that z is equal to the partition function on the cylinder. Okay, so this is the partition function. Now we are interested in the reduced density matrix rho A. If you understood what does it mean taking the trace for making this plot, it should be now automatic to understand what happened to rho A. Okay, what I should do, I should make A, let's say for simplicity, A is an interval. Let's denote by uv between the point uv at distance L, u minus v equal L, okay? So the interval between two points u and v, and their distance is L. Let's I have my rho, okay, where there are all the points. On this rho, I can identify where is A. A is here. To get rho A, what I should do? I should make the trace only over B, which is outside A. So it means that I should take this strip, close it to form a cylinder, okay, but then sum over only the part B and leave A unsummed. Okay, so if we do this, I can get this graphical path integral, which is just a cylinder, always of circumference beta, okay, where I sum everywhere, but here is A between U and V, okay, and here I'm not summing up, there are still the, I'm drawing like that to show that there is a, okay, there is a cut here. Let's use another color, which is nicer, okay. There is a cut here where on top I still have phi 1 of x1, which is an index of the matrix, and here I have still phi 2 of x2. Okay, which were the plus and minus of the spin chain. To make an analogy with what we have done before, that's why I'm doing, I have done this story, okay? I just erased the part rho A for the tensor network. We've wrote in this way, okay, where we left open indices on the part A and we contracted the part B. Okay, the analogy here is just obvious. We took the trace over the part B, so we closed the path integral. We don't contract indices, but we close the path integral, and we leave open cut like we leave open indices there on the part A. Okay, so I hope the analogy, that's analogy, the equivalence of the two things should be clear, okay? That's, and this is the main reason why I made that detour in Maverick protostate, because I guess that many of you are familiar with that, but not familiar with field theory, okay? Obviously, here it's missing still the normalization, Z. If you want a formula for this guy, this is the path integral over all the field configuration in imaginary time. Okay. Of the over the Euclidean action, as usual, where you impose the boundary condition. Let's write like that, product over x prime, delta of phi, x prime at phi equal to 0, should be equal to what we call phi 1 of x1, while Okay, so we take the path integral over all the field configuration weighted by the Euclidean action, where the field has the constraint that at imaginary time equal to 0 here should be equal to phi 1. Then I let imaginary time beta pass, I arrive on the other end of the object, and I impose the condition that phi at x phi at time imaginary time beta is equal to phi 2. And this is the formula in path integral that gives this plot. That the only thing that matters is this plot. Okay, but this plot, the formula means this. I should probably write it bigger. This x prime is a dummy indices, so it doesn't matter if it's x prime, y, z, call as you want. But what I want is just at any point, the field at time equal, imaginary time equal to 0 must be equal to phi 1. This is for any point in A, is where the cut is. In B, you are summing over all the configuration. You are taking the trace, which means you are doing the path integral. Okay? B becomes like all the other points here. It's A that still has an open cut. So X prime belonging to A, thank you for ever reminding me this, times product over x second belonging to A of delta phi x second beta minus phi 2. Thank you for the question, because I forgot to write that x belongs to A, and that's very important. Obviously, this is the element of the reduced density matrix. Then when you write for each element, you get the entire reduced density matrix. If you want, this is expectation value product over x prime phi 1 of x prime rho A product over x second phi 2. Okay? To be as clear as possible. Here there is the part normalization, and here there is the normalization. Thank you. Do you have questions? Okay, I think this is the right moment to have a break, because you can think the break usually is 10 minutes. Let's make people happy. We make a 15-minute break, but for 5 minutes, you don't go out of the room and think to this formula. Okay? If you don't understand something, you have the question ready for after. Okay? Because if you don't get this point, and what is the reduced density matrix is really useless that I continue. Okay, so I give you 5 minutes more break. Who understood, just have fun. Who didn't understand, thinks to this formula and make proper question where we reconvene at 10:15. Okay?
detto che c'era la bimba di Sebastian Cerisco, lei parla tre lingue, come sta parlando, 3 anni e mezzo,
cioè, David Weiss mi ha detto che lui ha detto la prima parola a 3 anni. Ma... mamma, cioè, c'è proprio...
No, ma posso dire che è una roba abbastanza...
Cioè... Sì, lo so, però, cioè, stai...
Adesso andiamo a fare una stanza di competenza perché sto diventando un alcolizzato cronico.
Cioè... Chi vai, su?
Eh?
Il studente con chi va?
No, mica, tutto a costo e tutto ospiti della gente.
Festeggiamo la fine della conferenza con la bevuta. Ma abbiamo suonato? Sì che abbiamo suonato. So everyone is in place. Did you think to questions? Yes.
So after all this, from the big one half, you said...
What do you mean to prove? How you...
How you have
to be able to do... Spin one half, what it means? That this notation, okay, think what it's here. Okay? You are just saying that obviously, you are in imaginary time, okay? But imagine this, the path integral, okay? So the integral over e to the minus sc provide you your state that in MPS is not written, but it's just this guy, okay? You can imagine, like, if you are, in, this is true for any state, okay, but we are at finite temperature, but imagine that you are at zero temperature, okay, it means that you should take the imaginary time evolution for infinite time, okay? And so, instead of having the cylinder, you just have a half plane, top that give you the state. So it's an infinite cylinder, okay, in the, for beta that goes to infinity, this plot for the density matrix become a plane where you have phi 1 here and phi 2 here, okay? The cylinder becomes a plane, okay? Okay, because what you do imaginary time evolution for infinite time and you project over the ground state. Okay, you take, if you make e to the minus beta h on an arbitrary state psi in the limit beta that goes to infinity, this project on the ground state, okay, with some normalization. And okay, it's clear this. Okay, so this is true for any state, not for the spin one half. So the ground state is given by applying the imaginary time operation for infinite time. Okay, now this is the ground state. Then I have to take the reduced density matrix, but I make exactly what is written here. I close on one side and I leave this state on the other side. Okay, so if I, this object is written here, is the expression plus, minus, 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 whatever you want. Okay, ground state. Ground state, because this is what it is, the density matrix at zero temperature, and another state here, minus, 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 plus, okay, whatever you want. Okay. And these two states here are the delta functions that are written here. So it's just, not to prove anything, you just have to rewrite this formula in terms of the spin one half. What I'm writing here, you see what it is. These two are identical objects. Yeah, sure, this is an infinite system. No, infinite in which, sorry? Which infinite? The state are infinite, yes. And then in the general case, also the fields can have whatever configuration you want. We don't know a priori, depends on the theory. But if it is a spin 1/2 system, it's just plus and minus. This, what I denote here by phi 1 of x prime and phi second of x second are just configuration of your system in that position, okay? And the configuration depends on the system. If for a spin 1/2, phi 1 and phi 2 can just be plus or minus, nothing else. If you have a spin 1, can be plus 1, 0, and minus. If you have a bosonic field, will be the mode occupation, local mode occupation, within 0 and infinity, okay? And then there are many other circumstances, obviously. The notation here is true for an arbitrary theory. Okay? You can specify to spin 1/2 in the ground state and finding exactly the construction we have written before. But thank you, it was a clarificatory point. Long story. In general, you cannot write a finite temporal state with an MPS, but you should use MPO matrix product operator. Okay, for the expert, it's just trivial. For the other, I'm just making random words that detach from the main object of the lecture. So if you want to discuss, we can discuss it, but it's definitely not important here. I want especially a simple question, okay? Like the one before was quite clarificatory. So don't be ashamed that it's stupid. The most stupid it is, the best it is, so we clarify more things. If you don't tell anything, it means that you understood everything, and you will not be allowed to say to ask things in the future about this. So, like in a wedding, talk now or be silent forever. Okay, could be that what you don't understand will be clearer while making something else. So just. Ask even after if something will be not clear. Okay, so we arrive to reduced density matrix. This is the expectation, how to write the expectation value on a state on a basis of the reduced density matrix in path integral. And now we have to use this expression to get the entanglement entropy. I remind you, first of all, that the entanglement entropy is given by S minus trace of rho A log rho A. But evaluating this logarithm, okay, for an operator is a complicated thing to do, as we already said yesterday. So what we will do, we will consider the moments trace of rho A to the n. Said already yesterday, we said that on that side, where there is trace of rho A squared and rho A cubed. Okay? We consider trace of rho A to the n for n integer. This will be easier. Okay? And then we will analytically continue n arbitrary real value, okay? If we manage, what this means will be clearer during the course, and then the entanglement entropy minus trace of rho A log rho A can be written as minus the derivative with respect to n of trace of rho A to the n, or equivalently as the limit, okay, this is for n that goes to 1, or equivalently as the limit for n that goes to 1 of the Rényi entropy that we wrote yesterday as 1 minus n logarithm of trace of rho A to the n. Okay. So this is, we are not able to compute this object directly, okay? Because to get the logarithm of an operator, what you should do, you should diagonalize first the operator, find the eigenvalues, and then put back in the original basis, but this will be too complicated, okay? No one knows how to do this, okay? And this, maybe if some of you is familiar with the theory of disorder system, is exactly the same story when you make the replica trick to get the average partition function that is logarithm of rho and not rho log rho, and that's why in that case you send n to 0 because you don't have this rho here. Here instead we have trace of rho log rho, and that's why we send n to 1. Okay, this is just a parenthesis for the people that know disorder system. If you don't know, not important. Okay. But it's exactly the same logic. Calculating logarithm of operator is complicated, and so you just calculate the moments, okay, and then try to make an analytic continuation if you manage, because it's not always easy. Now, how we calculate trace of rho A to the n? From what we have written, should be almost evident to all of you, okay, if you understood this, what is rho A, and if you understood how to make the multiplication of matrices, like it's written here, for example, for an MPS, you just put in your mind together the two things, and you should see it automatically. I'm just waiting for you to see it, and okay, if you didn't see yet, let's, for example, make trace of rho A cube, okay, which means that we have three of this cylinder that I draw in this way to have more space, okay, so. I have three of these infinite cylinder. Each of them is one of the rho A. This cylinder have these open cuts on A. Where, okay, on this side I have phi 1, on this side I have phi 2, which are my row and column index, okay? Here, let's say, I have phi 3, here I have phi 4, here I have phi 5, and here I have phi 6. Okay? Imagine just how you will write in normal trace of rho A to the n. You will write in terms of the indices as sum over I, j, k, rho A, I, j, rho A JK, rho A KI. Okay, so you contract row and column sequentially, and then you close the trace. Okay? The indices in this notation are just this field phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, etc. So what you should identify phi 2 with phi 3 and sum over them, which is equivalent to sum over J here. You should identify phi 4 with phi 3, and finally identify phi 1 with phi 6. Hmm? Okay, and notice the analogy with that row that is still there, and that's why I draw it. Okay, now you should imagine, again, you make trace of rho A cube, and there are no leftover indices and things, so just everything that is on top of this cut is identified with the bottom of this cut, okay? Everything that is on the other side here instead is identified with here, and this closes cyclically in this way. This is a drawing in field theory of this guy. It's exactly the same thing. Okay, that's why I didn't erase all the time this guy to have it available. And actually, to make it let me redraw it in the case of beta that goes to infinity. So now we go to the ground state, and we take the infinite plane. So I have three planes. With these open cuts, okay? And the down part of this guy is identified with the top here. The down of this is identified with the top here, and the bottom of this guy goes back cyclically, okay? So what does it mean? That we have a path integral, okay, that is defined on this surface. What does it mean, this surface? That, okay, usually if I move continuously, I just move like that, no? This is a line in this plane, okay? But what does this convention, like, I move, let's say that I move at fixed x in imaginary time, that is easier. If I move at fixed x in imaginary time on the B part of the system, I always remain on this plane, nothing happens, okay? Let's see instead what happens if I move at fixed x on the part A of the system. Okay, I start from x negative, okay? I go, I arrive to the cut here. But when I arrive to the cut, the bottom of this cut is connected with the top of here. I don't go out on the same plane, but I go out on this other plane. Okay, so this blue line makes this gain. Okay? Then I continue, I arrive to infinity. I reemerge from here, if you wish. Okay? Now let's just do another color. If I continue, if I move on this side, and arrive to the cut, I will reemerge here. Okay, so continuously, this point here and finally, if I move here, I reemerge here. If you want, continuity equation on this field is such that phi of x belonging to A, okay, let's phi of x and tau equal 0 minus, okay, it's phi of x belonging to the sheet 1. Okay. X belonging A in sheet 1 must be equal to phi of X, tau equals 0 plus, but with X belonging to A in sheet tune. Okay, so when you move here, you don't end up here like in B part. That seems to you something completely crazy. Did you ever see this thing in your life? Who has seen this thing? And not in field theory, who has seen it at second year of university or third year, maybe someone. Someone could have seen it in high school. If you are Russian, you have seen it in high school for sure. Every Italian have seen it at third year of university for sure. English even before, yes. So where do you have seen this strange construction? I hear Riemann sheet, that's the right answer. So I think any of you studied the square root. No? You all know the square root. Especially, you know the square root on the complex plane, on complex number. That's a bit, yeah, square root you know probably from 12 years old, square root on the complex plane a bit later. But when you study the square root, you say like, okay, let's make square root of z. You say that on the complex plane, the square root of z is a cut here, a branch cut. That's exactly what we have there. Okay, and actually, the square root is not defined on the plane, but is defined on a two-sheeted Riemann surface, which means that you have two planes. Okay, and when you go around the branch point, when you arrive here, exactly as I did before, you don't go out on this plane, but you go out here on the second sheet of the Riemann surface. And you have to turn two times around the branch point in order to come to the original point. Okay. This is for n equal to, okay, for the square root, we are just in suite on f n equal to, that you have to turn twice. Here, you have to turn three times around the branch point in order to come back to the original place, which means that is not the square root of that plot, but is z to the 1/3, okay? And anyhow, for any n, trace of rho to the n correspond to the Riemann surface of the power 1 over n. Okay, so it's not rocket science that it can seem. At the beginning, it's something that you already know, but okay. In a more complicated language. Is it clear? Yes. Yeah, beta, no, I took the t equal beta equal infinity limit, yes, in the for a cylinder, obviously, there is beta. But in this plot, I put beta equal to infinity to have things easier. Okay, so this was beta, and here I took the limit. Which I mean, I'm on the ground state. Thank you for the question, and okay, this kind of question are very much appreciated, so. No, no, it's not similarity. It's these are branch cuts. This object, okay, this thing that I wrote here is a Riemann surface, is a three-sheeted Riemann surface. Okay? There is, it's not a similarity. It's a three-sheeted Riemann surface. In fact, okay, let me continue here. What we obtain is that trace of rho a to the n, except the z that gets lost everywhere, there is 1 over z to the n here, and there is 1 over z to the n here. Trace of rho a to the n is, okay, is equal to, let's write like that, z n depending on a divided z 1 to the a, z that one without a to the n, okay, where z n of a is the partition function of the field theory in an n-sheeted Riemann surface with branch cut in the interval UV we are studying. I read it if you don't read. Okay. Trace of rho a to the n is equal to the ratio of zn, depending on a, which means the interval uv, divide z1 to the n, which means the partition function on the plane to the power n. It's just a normalization. Because each of these cylinders brings one z, no? The partition function, the density matrix was 1 over z cylinder. So we have n of them, so there is 1 over z to the n. So zn of a that appear here in the numerator is the partition function of the quantum field theory in an n-sheeted Riemann surface with branch cut on the interval a that is equal to uv. Okay? Questions? Yes. Or do you talk loudly or I come up? Yeah, okay, these are trivial modifications. You should just put some defect line somewhere and things can be done, but okay, it's really a detour that will not be fundamental for understanding. You can take into account whatever open boundary condition, fixed antiperiodic boundary condition, many things of this kind. It's just small modification of this, of what, there are some insertion of operator somewhere, okay? But it's easy. Yeah, that's what we will do Friday to get something. Okay, that's exactly the way to get make calculation then. Yes. Or? Okay, everything I wrote here, as I wrote at the beginning, is valid in arbitrary dimension. The only thing that you should take care that the surface, what you get in higher dimension is not called Riemann surface, just has not a name because there are no complex numbers, etc. But there is the same thing, object connected on surfaces in a strange way, perfectly done. This is used in many circumstances, just it's not called Riemann surface, but okay. Actually, we can decide to call higher dimensional Riemann surface and we are okay. Just apart from the name, everything is the same. Obviously, you don't have the nice interpretation of the complex plane because in higher dimension, okay, you don't have a complex plane, but apart from that, it's valid. Okay, so basically, with this construction, what we show is that trace of rho a to the n, that's what we want, is a partition function on some strange surface. Okay? You agree on this. If you didn't make question, it means that you agree on this. Calculating partition function is something that is in many circumstances, especially in field theory, but also for a lattice model, you can think of making the same thing, okay? In fact, we had this lattice spacing at the beginning that in the course of the writing just disappeared because it doesn't matter too much, okay? But this is valid in general. Our trace of rho e to the n is a partition function on an n-sheeted Riemann surface, and calculating partition function is much easier than calculating an object like trace of rho e log rho e that you need the operatorial knowledge of the density matrix. Instead, in this case, you don't need anything. You just need to calculate the partition function. Okay, so this is a real major simplification. Okay? So if you don't have question, I will move to introduce another auxiliary concept that in some cases is very useful and maybe it helps before making any calculation, it helps digesting what this formula means. Okay, and the concept I want to introduce is the one of the twist field. It's a strange name that goes back to the 80s when it was introduced in string theory, and okay, it reappears here for, because what string theorists do is to calculate partition function of strange Riemann surfaces, okay? That should be, maybe you have heard about this story. They have Calabi-Yau manifold that are very complicated. We have just a Riemann surface, but the same kind of structure emerge. So if you want, we are making applied string theory. So the partition function on the n-sheeted Riemann surface, what I call ZA of A, where A, again, is, just in case you miss, is UV, the interval. This object, we said it's a partition function, that means I can write over integral over all the field configuration phi of x and tau, where now this field lives on this n-sheeted Riemann surface that let me denote by Rn, okay? So with this notation, I mean that I should consider all the field configuration that live on this Riemann surface, Rn, which is that surface over there. So the field does not live on the plane like before, but live on the Riemann surface. And then e to the minus integral over this Riemann surface of dx d tau, Lagrangian density of the field, phi, at x and tau, okay? And the local, because of the construction that we made, the Lagrangian density is the same as our original model, okay? On the plane. We had a model on the plane, okay? We didn't change model in making this thing. We just start, we desire to calculate the partition function of the very same model on this strange surface. So the Lagrangian density is exactly the same as before. Okay, so this is the same that we wrote. The only thing that is complicated is that all x and t, all x and tau as coupled belongs to this n-sheeted Riemann surface. Okay, and that's what this mean. Your colleague here said you can map this to the, to put the branch cut in the real negative axis. You can do this, but then you need to know what happened to this, how the Lagrangian transform, In general, this is very complicated, but there is one case where under conformal transformation things transform very well, that are the conformal field theory. Okay, this is what we will do during the next last lecture to see in one case how you can really play with this object to get an answer. Okay? In general, it's much more complicated because it's not natural. Objects don't transform nicely under conformal field theory, conformal transformation. Okay? So this is what we want to calculate. And as written in this formula, I repeat, we have a field, only one field, phi, that lives on this strange surface. Okay? Now, for understanding what we are doing, and for many applications also, it's useful to think, to divide that partition function, okay, to think this partition function here as an expectation over n different fields, one of which lives on a single sheet of the Riemann surface, okay? We can do this, okay, we can take, instead of thinking a single field where x goes from minus infinity plus infinity and tau goes on three different sheets, okay? Let's think of having n field. We have phi 1, okay? Let's try to rewrite this in terms of n different fields, phi 1 of x tau, phi 2 of x tau, phi n of x tau, each of them, okay, where x and tau now will live on the complex plane. Okay? You see, it's just exactly the same thing. Instead of having one field that goes from one place to another, I want different fields, each one lives on one of the sheets of the Riemann surface. These fields cannot do whatever they want. They should satisfy, if I want to map that object to this plot, they should satisfy this condition, no? So they should satisfy some condition to map that, and okay, so our partition function, ZNA, that's how we denoted it, will be equal to the path integral over d phi 1, this living on the complex plane, d phi 2 living on the complex plane, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, up to d phi n on the complex plane, time e to the minus integral over dx d tau, always on the complex plane, of the Lagrangian of phi 1 plus the Lagrangian of phi 2, et cetera, et cetera. Lagrangian of phi 1, Lagrangian of phi 2 are always the same as before. The only thing is that this field, this path integral here now has a constraint that I will call CUV because it depends on the interval A that is defined between U and V. And the constraint is the following. CUV is the constraint that phi I of x and 0 plus is equal to phi I plus 1 x of 0 minus if x belong to A. Where I is defined mod n. Okay. So that the last one is equal to the first. Okay. So, if you think I'm just rewriting, okay, I didn't make any. I just change basis, if you want. I wrote exactly the same object, but instead of a single field in terms of n fields, but this n field cannot do whatever they want. They have to satisfy this constraint in order to be on the Riemann surface, in order to be equivalent to the Riemann surface, OK? Question, because we are going to finish soon, so. Up here. Here. I just say, is defined mod n, which means that n plus 1, okay, let's write even easier, n plus 1 is equal to 1. Okay, that's what it means, that thing. Because obviously, when I arrive to n here, I get phi of n plus 1. What does it mean, n plus 1? It's cyclic, it means 1. Thank you for the question, because if you don't understand this, obviously you don't understand anything. We didn't get yet there, okay? It's the last 5 minutes will be that, but first make question. We are almost there. Okay? Notice that the total Lagrangian that appear here, which we can call Ln, which depends on all the fields, phi 1 to phi n, is nothing but the sum of the individual Lagrangian that are all the same, okay? So if Lagrangian are additive, it means that even energy is additive because it's just a Legendre transform of this guy, okay? So also the energy is just additive between the various surfaces. Okay, so it seems we have been playing and doing nothing. But we have done something, because now this Zn, as it's written here, is not defined anymore on the Riemann surface, but is defined on the plane. Then in this way is defined on the plane. But is it a partition function of the theory on the plane? Okay, the answer is no, because this will be trivial. The partition function of the theory on the plane will be just the partition function of the system. This constraint makes the things non-trivial, okay? And this constraint up and all at two points, u and v. So it's something on the plane where something, okay, so it's, then it's defined on the plane, okay, in which there is some non-trivial action. the non-trivial action. Action is at U and V. Okay, something non-trivial happens only there. Okay, usually, you call this thing, this is a correlation function then. On the plane. And in fact, we usually write this thing as tau n u tau tilde n v on the complex plane, okay? Where? Now, u and v, you know we are on the complex plane. Tau n u and tau n v, tau n are called twist field. And they are defined by this relation, okay? Don't ask me what are the twist field. One can think, can make things a bit more precise and constructive and rigorous from the mathematical point of view, but okay, it's not that that we are aiming in this lecture, because it will be too complicated, but to understand that here the action happens only in two points, okay? What is special about this function is that the constraint is imposed at some point, okay? And if you think, what is a correlation function? It's when you put something at one point. Usually you put an operator. Now, instead of the operator, I put a constraint. And this constraint defines me an operator, a field that I call twist. Okay, why it's called twist, it's a long story that is not the, will take us away. But the important thing that I want you to understand is that, okay, by rewriting this object in terms of the copies of the field, okay, defined on the complex plane, you end up in an object that is identical to a correlation function on the plane of some object that are defined through this equation. Okay? And actually, as every time in field theoretical language, the operator never exists only the correlation function of the operator. So if one wants to be rigorous, this is completely fine. Maybe you heard this story, know that in field theory operator don't really exist, exist only the correlation function of the operator. Okay, so this is even. This twist field can have many nice properties, okay, but we are not interested in them here, okay? We are just interested in the rewriting of the partition function. Okay, so let's write the final story. I just rewrite that so I finish and then we make all the questions. The partition function on the n-sheeted Riemann surface is equivalent to the correlation function of some field that we call twist fields, or twist fields, or twist field, in a theory, in a replicated theory. In the sense that now we have n fields, we don't have any more one field. Okay? So I reread the sentence because maybe I wrote too fast. The partition function on the n-sheeted Riemann surface, which is traced of rho to the n, is equivalent to the correlation function of twist fields in a replicated theory. Okay? That's the message of this twist field. It's equivalent by construction, and by construction we define the correlation function of these fields. Okay? Now, the lecture of today is finished, so go on with all the questions. No.
No.
Twist field is something else. There is no really, it's not a field of the theory. It's something defined to satisfy that relation. Okay? You can write, if you wish, and this is quite complicated, and definitely, you know field theory? Okay, so you can write an operator product expansion for two of these guys to get, in terms of the regular fields of the theory. This you can do, but the field itself is not directly related to it. So it's like in any OP, you have the OP with two fields that becomes other fields. Doesn't mean that the field itself is the other field. Okay, so the OP of this tau can be written in terms of the field of theory, but the field itself is not a field of the theory. That's the, okay, for the people that understand what is an OP, that's a very general statement. Okay, the people that don't know OP just ignore the sentence. Sorry, I didn't hear. Tilde is just, what happened in U is different from what happened in V, okay? Because, no, it's two different fields. It's like field and anti-field, if you want, okay? And this is the usual notation. This is not the same field in U and V, because what happened in U is different from what happened in V. Yes, there is, but it's too complicated to explain here. There is a relation, okay? It's really the inverse field, okay? In some sense, but okay, this will take me. What I've written here shows you that this object should be written as a correlation function of two fields that in general are different. Obviously then, in order for this correlation function to be non-zero, it means that this object should have the same scaling dimension and some other things that, but okay, just for the sake of this lecture, I can write this. This defines the two fields. These two fields should be in some relation that, for the moment, stay unspecified. Good question. Imagine you are on this line, okay? And then you have U here and V here, okay? Now, let's explain. We answer two questions at the same time, okay? So since you asked, you didn't realize that it's the same question as your friend. Yeah, but it is the same question. So when you are in B, the field is just continuous, okay? So there is no phi. You arrive to U, okay? So you move along X now, okay? You arrive to the point U. At the point U, you meet this tau and U. Tau and U tells you that when you now move along this line, field phi I here should be identified with field phi I plus 1 here, or vice versa. I don't remember which notation I use, but it doesn't matter, you understand. Okay, so this is tau. And then after, it doesn't happen anything. It's always, it continues to be true until you arrive at V, when you get tau tilde and V, okay, which makes the opposite operation, okay, and tells you, so since it's opposite, basically annihilates the action of this guy, and after, everything is continuous again. So in this sense, tau and V, tau tilde and V, is the inverse of this guy. Okay? So, and that's why it's applied only in U and V. You move along this line, and you see that the field here is continuous. The first time that you make this twist field, you go up in, you change the field from I to I plus 1, okay? So the action of tau tilde is to change I to I plus 1. So what tau tilde nu does is to change phi I is ident of x 0 plus is equal to phi I plus 1, x 0 minus, or vice versa, this doesn't matter too much, for all x larger than u. Okay? Instead, tau n tilde, or whatever, of v, makes phi I zero x 0 plus to be equal to phi I minus 1, x 0 minus. For all x smaller, larger than v. So if you are to a point here, you add in the back both tau n and tau n tilde. This brought you up on 1, this brought you down on 1, and in total you stay in the same place, okay? So, clear why it's only in u and v? Clear why tau n and tau n tilde are 1? For you, it's clear now why they are the opposite of the other, so I answer 2 questions in 1, and okay, we are happy. Yes? I can do it. I set the branch point to infinity. Like, imagine the square root. I set the branch point to infinity. It means, okay, that probably this trace of rho to the n will be just goes to 0, obviously, but you can do it. It will be clearer in the next lecture what happened, but okay, that's. But there is nothing pathological in doing that. And, okay, just. No, 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 I think the best thing to do, yeah, you can come to me, but apart from that, the best thing to do is that you, I introduced several different difficult concepts, so think to that. We can, if you want, we can start Friday lecture with the question that you can have, just write down, and I'm very happy to answer them, okay?